This week on Christian World News, a Christmas story that will warm your heart. See how orphans in India are getting a very special gift this year. And meet the 96-year-old woman who's making it all possible from half a world away.
Plus, we explore the meaning of a timeless Christmas carol and hear it performed like never before.
And the man behind a classic Christmas story, what you didn't know about Charles Dickens and his faith. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Christmas edition of Christian World News. I'm George Thomas.
I think you're excited about Christmas.
I am, absolutely.
Me too. Well, thanks so much for being with us. We begin with two Regent University students, a 96-year-old American woman, and orphans in India, and how their lives are tied together with a common thread of love.
These orphans in India don't know it yet, but they're getting something special for Christmas this year. Coming from someone they've never met, half a world away in Virginia. 95-year-old Connie Vitolo has spent the past year making blankets for the children, one stitch at a time.
Well, how many blankets have you crocheted for the orphans so far?
A dozen. 12, and I'm on my 13th
one. Number 13 right now. And I understand that you pray over every blanket.
Oh, I pray for every one of them. I pray to Jesus and I thank him every day. When I finish one, I said, thank you, Jesus. Don't let me die before I finish my blanket.
Not long ago, Mrs. Vitolo didn't care whether she lived or died. After a bad fall, she had to leave her New Jersey home and move in with her daughter in Virginia. Before long, depression set in.
And I say, I wish I would, could Jesus would call me home. But my daughter says, no, he don't want you yet.
I prayed. I said, Lord, you know, I'm putting it all in your hands and I'm trusting you that you're going to make a way for her to have, you know, to find her purpose here, you know. And he did.
Anne saw an ad on a bulletin board that volunteers were needed to make items for orphans in India. Mrs. Vitolo found her purpose.
She really has a lot of joy just doing this. She can do it all day long, and she just doesn't get tired.
What that lady is doing, it's amazing, because something that is giving her life, which is also breathing in life and nurture to a child in another country.
Ranjit Abraham knows what it's like to be without a purpose. He grew up in the shadow of his father, a well-known pastor in India who founded 17 orphanages.
I never wanted to be a part of this because I don't know how it is in this country, but in my country, when you become a pastor and you come to the bottom of the food chain.
Ranjit was pursuing a graduate degree at Regent University when an unlikely partnership emerged.
Out of all my classmates, there's one in particular that I don't necessarily get along with, being an African-American woman from New York City, having a very strong personality, and he being an Indian male from a very
chauvinistic
country. So we didn't get along. But God had a bigger plan.
Ranjit and Aisha are now best friends, part of a movement called Glocalization, encouraging people to serve at a local level for global impact. After finishing graduate school, Ranjit returned to India. He and Aisha work across the globe to provide his father's orphanages with more than basic needs, like playrooms for children who never had toys, or homemade blankets to cover them with warmth and love. They see Mrs. Vitolo as a perfect example of a glocal servant.
To have a little Italian grandmother in the middle of America to say, I'll take my frail hands and I will create something for you that's a practical need.
Versus like, man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at your heart. What does that mean to us? But when you see what Mrs. Vitolo is doing, it makes complete sense, you know?
Oh, here he is.
Once a year, Ranjit returns to the United States. This time, he made a new friend.
Hello!
Ranjit.
Yes!
How are you? I'm fine. I'm gonna make blankets for your little orphans.
Oh my God, so good to see you.
You are good looking, buddy.
Am I? Do you want me to show you some pictures of the kids sure. that are going to get this?
Yeah, I would love to see them.
Can you see that?
Mm.
That's them.
Ah.
They've come from the streets, you know? They don't have a parent.
Right.
They don't have a mother. They don't
That's
have a father.
What I want. People that don't have anybody. And if this one of these can cover them when they're cold, I'll be happy. I wish I had one here. I would hug him, kiss her. Jesus has a purpose for us all, but I never thought he had a purpose like this for me. And I'm very happy and honored and humble. Jesus, I love you. I thank you and I praise you all my days until the day I come home to you.
George,
what a terrific,
she was
I mean,
such
what a
an
darling.
Inspiration.
Yeah, imagine 96 years old and still knows that she has a purpose.
Absolutely. Yeah, what an inspiration, especially around this time of year.
Fantastic.
Amen.
Well, folks, here in the U.S., a group called REITs Across America honors hundreds of thousands of veterans each Christmas. The organization set a new goal this year to place a remembrance wreath on every veteran's headstone at Arlington National Cemetery. And as my colleague John Jessup tells us, the support, well, it has been overwhelming.
I'm standing here now to let you know that because of the support, we're going to do it. We've got the wreath.
Wayne Hansen is the chairman of Wreaths Across America. His goal this year? Raise enough money to place 230,000 wreaths on each headstone at America's most sacred shrine. He told CBN News the kindness of Americans this Christmas brought him to tears.
To see the people out here today coming in, I started to cry again. I'm sorry, but it's just amazing to see the people to support them, waving the flags, the kids holding the signs. It really has been fantastic.
This year marks the 23rd anniversary of wreath laying here at Arlington Cemetery. It also marks the largest number of wreaths ever sponsored and delivered.
Over the weekend, volunteers placed the $15 wreaths at over 900 cemeteries in all 50 states and even overseas. Misty Stratton brought her young daughter with a special reason in mind.
We started a new tradition with Sophia, so we wanted to get her to understand how important it is for each holiday to thank the veterans for what they sacrificed for us.
Board member Edith Knowles came to honor her brother, who died in the service.
I wanted to bring my brother here because he's never had the opportunity. He was killed on the battlefield in World War II. And I'm here to help bring the warmth of Christmas to the gravesite of the fallen.
Remember, honor, teach. That's the mission of Wreaths Across America, which started in 2007 to carry on the annual wreath-laying ceremony at Arlington that began many years before, back in 1992.
They'll know that people do care about their service and sacrifice of their loved ones and that they won't be forgotten.
In all, Americans placed more than 700,000 remembrance wreaths on veterans' graves this Christmas season, but the number of people who've been touched is countless.
Thanks so much, John. Well, coming up, we go to a Jerusalem church to hear a favorite Christmas carol and discover the meaning behind O Come, Emmanuel.
Hello, I'm Terry Newsom. Did you know there are more than 148 million orphans in the world today? 148 million. But it was three little girls that taught me about the plight of orphans. 8 years ago, my husband and I spent nearly a month immersed in the daily activities of a Ukrainian orphanage as we waited to adopt three sisters. I saw firsthand the utter loneliness, the pain of rejection, and the overwhelming desire to be loved. That experience changed me forever. And out of it grew a ministry from my heart called Orphans Promise. Today, we're helping orphans and vulnerable children in more than 50 countries worldwide. Thousands of children are now in safe homes. They're being educated, and they're learning life skills. I'm asking you to join with me and become family to these children. Will you call the number on your screen right now? Because every child deserves a chance to be happy.
Inside every child is a hero, a leader, a friend to others, someone who helps out, who does the right thing, who dreams of what they can be, but they still need our help.
What should I do?
What should I say?
How should I feel?
That's where Superbook comes in. It provides moral and spiritual truths through situations children can relate to, teaching God's word to the children you love. Join the Superbook DVD Club and receive Superbook's newest episodes as they're available, plus two copies to share with others, all for your gift of only $25. Get Superbook today and watch the miracles happen.
As you know, Christmas is a reminder of the power of Jesus Christ to change lives. One Christmas carol sums up that power. It's called, O Come, O Come Emmanuel.
That's right. Claire Fawn from the University of the Holy Land explains the song as it's performed by violinist Maurice Seclar in Jerusalem's St. Anne's Church.
O Come, O Come Emmanuel is really a beloved hymn. And most people don't realize that this hymn was composed to be an Advent song, not a Christmas carol at all. Each one is based on one of the titles of the Messiah that is found in the Old Testament. O Come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. Emmanuel, of course, is the title given to the Messiah in Isaiah chapter 7, where Isaiah prophesies that a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and will call his name Emmanuel. The Gospel of Matthew applies this very scripture to Jesus at his birth. Another one of the titles applied to the Messiah that was adapted into this song is the Rod of Jesse. O come, thou Rod of Jesse, come. The Rod of Jesse is referred to in Isaiah chapter 11. And the Rod of Jesse refers, of course, to the kingship, to the ruling. Jesse was the father of David. And so when we sing of the Rod of Jesse, we're singing of the descendant of David, the Messiah, Jesus. One of the verses calls for the dayspring from on high to arise. O come thou dayspring, come and cheer our hearts. The dayspring refers to Malachi chapter 4, where we read that the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. This verse does not refer as much to the kingship of the Messiah, but it refers to his tenderness, to his personalness, to his compassion for those who are weary, for those who suffer and toil, for those who are ill, crying out that the day spring, the Son of Righteousness will come with healing, not only for our bodies, but for our hearts, our souls, and our spirits. Many of the titles that are used in the hymn, O Come Emmanuel, come from the book of Isaiah. Another one is the Key of David. O come thou Key of David, come and open up the way to our heavenly home. The Key of David comes from Isaiah 22, and it speaks of that opening to passage, to freedom of access that is echoed in the book of Revelation, when Jesus in the book of Revelation gives the Key of David, which opens doors that no man can shut. Another very beautiful theme that is touched on in the hymn is when they refer to the Messiah as the Lord of Might. The Lord of Might, of course, comes from Isaiah when it speaks in Isaiah chapter 11 that upon him will rest the spirit of counsel and wisdom and might and understanding. But the hymn reflects on the Lord of Might as being the one who gives the word of the Lord. On Sinai's height gave the law. And of course, the word of the Lord is not simply the law, but it's really Jesus himself. Jesus is the Word of God. The song, O Come Emmanuel, is evoking that longing and expectation that we have. We celebrate that Jesus has already come, but we know that something is not yet complete. So it's a very beautiful song because it has an echo of the past, but a tremendous anticipation of that glorious coming when the rod of Jesse, the key of David, the one who is almighty, God with us, will establish his kingdom on earth. I like to think of Emmanuel, God with me today, God perfectly present, God who brings his salvation at this moment, God who became Jesus, who showed his love for us in laying down his life, who calls me by name, who calls each of us by name, who loves us as a father, who loves us as a shepherd, who loves us as a king. Today he cries out for the salvation of each human being. Today is the day of salvation. We don't have to wait till tomorrow. We can celebrate Emmanuel, God with us, today.
Yeah, beautiful. You know, you sing that song, O come, Emmanuel. We think of it during Christmas time.
Right.
But as Christians, we say, Lord, come. We look forward to your return.
Come, Lord Jesus.
O come, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah, beautiful. Well, our Jerusalem team has created its own Christmas program with more special reports from the Holy Land. You can watch it at Jerusalem Dateline page on our website. Find it at cbnnews.com. We'll be back right after this.
Up next, the lost story from author Charles Dickens. Hear what it's about and how it sheds new light on Dickens' own life.
Is this thing on? Hey, kids, do you love games? And do you love discovering things? Yeah! Well, do ya? Yeah!
Then you're gonna love this. It's the new free Superbook Kids Bible app. You can play games, watch videos, find answers to your questions, and a whole lot more. The new Superbook Kids Bible app. Free downloads available on iTunes and Google Play now.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, New York.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore. CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom, I'm there.
Embassy in Washington, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
Hello, I'm Terry Newsom. Did you know there are more than 148 million orphans in the world today? 148 million. But it was three little girls that taught me about the plight of orphans. 8 years ago, my husband and I spent nearly a month immersed in the daily activities of a Ukrainian orphanage as we waited to adopt three sisters. I saw firsthand the utter loneliness, the pain of rejection, and the overwhelming desire to be loved. That experience changed me forever. And out of it grew a ministry from my heart called Orphans Promise. Today, we're helping orphans and vulnerable children in more than 50 countries worldwide. Thousands of children are now in safe homes. They're being educated and they're learning life skills. I'm asking you to join with me and become family to these children. Will you call the number on your screen right now? Because every child deserves a chance to be happy. It's a holiday tradition for many families, watching or reading Charles Dickens' classic story, A Christmas Carol.
However, few really know much about the man who wrote the story. And as Mark Martin reports, although the work of Dickens is still studied today, few people know about his faith.
Yes, you, my good fellow. What day is today?
Today? Well, it's Christmas Day, of course.
Christmas Day. I haven't missed it.
From the screen to the stage. The transformation of Ebenezer Scrooge from miser to cheerful giver strikes a chord in the hearts of adults and children.
There goes Mr. Humbug, there goes Mr. Grimm. If they gave a prize for being mean, the winner would be him.
All these versions are the result of Charles Dickens' classic novel, A Christmas Carol. The legendary 19th century English writer loved the holiday. He was even quoted as saying, "I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it all the year."
Mankind was my business.
The common welfare was my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, and benevolence were all my business.
Scholar and author Dr. Gary College has studied Dickens extensively. The Akron, Ohio native even studied in the UK, earning a PhD at the prestigious University of St. Andrews for his work on the faith of Dickens.
That's what's going to be prevalent in anything we read by Dickens, that idea that real Christianity, and Dickens uses that term real Christianity a number of times in letters and in his writing. Real Christianity is being like Jesus.
During his research, College discovered that Dickens was a Christian, and his faith in Jesus Christ surfaces throughout his works in the themes and characters. He read a letter for us from Dickens to one of his critics.
All my strongest illustrations are derived from the New Testament. All my social abuses are shown as departures from its spirit. All my good people are humble, charitable, faithful, forgiving. Over and over again, I claim them in express words as disciples of the founder of our religion.
For example, in A Christmas Carol, College says Marley's warning to Scrooge about what it means to truly live life reflects the importance of imitating Christ.
The taking care of humanity, the thinking about my fellow man, doing unto others as I'd have them do unto me. For Dickens, the golden rule was absolutely crucial.
College believes the most definitive evidence for the Christian faith of Charles Dickens is this little-known work written during the height of his career over a period of 3 years for his children. It's simply titled, The Life of Our Lord.
Critics are right. It's not a fantastic piece of literature, but it is, it shines a bright light on Dickens' faith because he is the sole editor of this thing.
College calls The Life of Our Lord a gospel harmony, where the author interweaves the four gospels into a single narrative. In this case, Dickens summarized the life of Christ for the next generation, his children.
My dear children, I'm very anxious that you should know something about the history of Jesus Christ, for everybody ought to know about him.
Gospel harmonies were very important in the 19th century. A Christian family at that time would have had at least two books in their home, the Bible and a gospel harmony.
The spiritual formation of his children is nothing that Dickens would leave to someone else. He just wouldn't have done that. So this would have been a very important tool in the Dickens family for religious instruction, for instruction in Christian thinking.
College says very few people know about this part of Dickens' work or his Christian faith. Literary critics dismissed his religion as unimportant and superficial, and educators followed suit. Even College found himself criticized when presenting his dissertation at St. Andrews.
That I would be so audacious as to suggest that this icon of British literature was somehow a man of faith. I don't know how to explain that hostility other than people like darkness better than light.
Over the years, it hasn't always been negative. A handful of literary scholars have discussed the faith of Dickens. To shine the light much brighter on the Christian beliefs of one of the greatest writers in history, College says he believes God wanted him to write this book. It's entitled God and Charles Dickens, Recovering the Christian Voice of a Classic Author, a book released this year, which is the 200th anniversary of Dickens' birth.
All of that was providential and guided by our Lord. It was actually rather easy to get a publisher. That's not always true. It's just a good feeling to when you know the Spirit of God is involved and this is not your project.
He dedicates the book to his grandchildren, writing, "May you each find joy, as did Dickens, in our Savior." Mark Martin, CBN News, Akron, Ohio.
Thanks, Mark. Love that story. And you can give these great stories to others for Christmas. Simply go to our CWN Facebook page and share them with your family and friends. We'll be right back.
Come on, give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there.
providing food,
thank you,
and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place.
Here you go.
My life is hectic, so I joined CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are.
Hi, good morning. Are you ready to get started?
We all want to live in the favor and anointing of God. We want His wisdom to solve problems and His provision for all we need. The Bible tells us the Lord has put eternity in our hearts. Each of us wants the certainty of heaven, to know our lives have purpose and that we are playing a vital role in accomplishing His plan for all mankind.
In Pat and Gordon Robertson's latest DVD teaching, Living Under God's Blessing, you'll discover how to receive wisdom to solve today's problems, the keys to provision for meeting all your needs, and how you can be a part of His plan for the world today. Call now to receive Living Under God's Blessing, featuring the 3-time Emmy-nominated series, Made in Israel.
May God bless you, and may you enjoy and live under the blessing of the Lord always.
Living Under God's Blessing, available now.
And finally on the broadcast this week, a new exhibition brings together some of the world's most beautiful, diverse art focusing on Mary, the mother of Jesus.
Paul Strand visited Washington's National Museum of Women in the Arts to take a look.
In the book of Luke, the angel Gabriel brings good news that changes the world forever, saying to Mary, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Now the mother of Jesus is being honored with a special art exhibit in our nation's capital. These works of art come from the Vatican, the Louvre, and the Uffizi in Florence, as well as private collections. Monsignor Timothy Verdon, a foremost scholar on Mary, said American audiences expect to see strong and complex women in their literature, shows, and films. But they may be surprised to find artists of the Middle Ages and Renaissance portray Mary that way.
There was a similar interest in the woman as a figure of courage, the woman as a figure of individuality, the woman as capable of a range of thought and of feeling that perhaps is never represented in a comparable way in men.
Many of the works show the early joy-filled days of Mary with her newborn son. Here she's called Madonna, which simply means Milady. On the other hand, several works concentrate on that hard, harsh day when Mary had to stand by helplessly as her Jesus was slain on a cross. All will be on display in Washington's National Museum of Women and the Arts till April 12th.
Believers over the centuries have loved Mary not just because of who she is, but her faith and her words of wisdom. When we first see her in the scriptures, she's saying, "Be it unto me according to thy will." And she gives us probably the best advice of all about how to relate to Jesus. When she told a group of men in John 2, "Do whatever he tells you." Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from the National Museum of Women and the Arts.
Thank you, Paul.
That's good advice.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Do whatever Jesus tells you.
That's right. Well, folks, that's it for the special edition of Christian World News.
We pray you and your family have a great Christmas holiday. Until next week, goodbye. And from all of us here at Christian World News, God bless you.